for joining us.
Good morning, Nikki, and to all your viewers. Thank you for having me in your show.
Okay, so first off, as said, we know the bill was passed on second reading last August 2 by the House of Representatives Ways and Means Committee and is expected to be taking up on third reading when lawmakers resume sessions, you know, after the ECQ. Now you're appealing that to the Senate for the swift passage of a counterpart bill, Sana, so that it can be enacted by September. But how confident are you that this can happen, considering it wasn't really certified as urgent by President Duterte during his SONA?
We feel confident because the Speaker of the House, Lord Alan Velasco, said it should be a priority measure. Education should be a priority measure of the House. That's why we are grateful to Kong Joey Salceda and even majority Kong Joey Salceda and the 74 other Solons who immediately supported the swift action, and even to Minority Leader Martin Romualdez for taking up it on the floor. And so it's a priority already of the House Speaker. And we also learned that from the Ways and Means Committee Chair of the Senate, Senator Pia, that she is already anxiously waiting also it for the bill, SB 9311, to be passed immediately to the Senate. And we already have spoken also to Senator Pia, even during the recess, of which we are very grateful to her because she took off some time during the recess to already tackle the issues during one session. And she already said, to quote her, that she believes it would be an easy pass. But we are also thanking the 14 other senators who pushed for this bill, and especially also Senator Sunny Angara, who co-authored this bill. So with the majority also in the Senate, we are hopeful that they will pass it easily, as even Senator Pia said, it could be a sweep.
And following this, do you think the Senate should just adopt the House's version of the bill to, you know, speed things up?
Well, that depends on the BICAM. But again, what is important to us here in Cocopea, represented by around 2,500 educations, is that the true spirit and intent of this curative and clarificatory law will once and for all put proprietary educational institutions to the 10% preferential rate over time. I think that's what's important for us. That should be placed in the law.
Mm-hmm. And we also have other educational groups expressing hope that the bill would be signed into law before school officially starts in about a month, so that our schools can fully focus on dealing with the learning crisis amid the pandemic. Could you expound more on the impact of the pandemic on private schools, as well as how they are coping right now with our COVID situation?
Yeah, Nikki, you know, as you know, all of us were caught by surprise with this pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. And one of the industries utterly and severely battered is education. And we immediately, but again, what's important for us is learning must continue no matter what happens, whether there's a pandemic or not. So we had to shift to immediately to digital transformation or online, actually it's flexible learning options, but in layman's parlance, it's distance or online learning. So in order for us, so that the agility that we were able to exercise in order to shift our mode to make learning continuous. But it has indeed a devastating effect on the education industry. Some statistics are, we have around 1,100 schools that have suspended or closed operations. We have also around 900,000 students, Nikki, who did not anymore go back to school. And then we also have around 400 students who transferred from the private to the public schools. And then we have several thousands of teachers who are also affected by unemployment. And most important, this pandemic really caused a radiating wave of destruction because there are community radiating wave of destruction around the communities of the school. Because as you know, Nikki, there are several related small and medium businesses relying on the schools, from the school bus services, the bookstores, the karinderias, the canteens, and all these ancillary services were also severely affected by the pandemic. And even up to now, we are severely affected because it's the pandemic. We don't know when it's going to end. Face-to-face classes hasn't really started in the basic education. And but of course, at any rate, safety, in terms of coping, safety would really be paramount. And the school associations have been talking constantly with each other on sharing best practices of what they learned, on what works and what doesn't work. So those are the examples of the coping mechanisms that we have done to survive this pandemic.
Now, we have Representative Joy Salceda also highlighting that applying the reduced 1% preferential rate under CREATE bill until 2023 would allow schools to save an equivalent of about 3.43% of compensation expenses. Will there be efforts to provide relief as well as to rehire their teachers? Where else can these additional funds be used to better support our private schools and the education sector?
Well, Nikki, just as a background, briefly, as you know, the education industry has already been battered, but it was a necessary pill to swallow, the K to 12. So we had to transfer from K to 10 to K to 12 system. And now we are now facing this pandemic. Now, as you know, distance learning or flexible learning options, but I think the most understandable word would be distance learning, is important because schools are remain closed because safety is paramount to our students. So what we have been doing is investing in technology. It's really digital transformation. It's technology investments in technology wherein you can enhance and engage your students digitally and replicate the classroom experience, as well as we're also investing in simulations because you cannot, so to replicate the laboratory. And another equal important factor, as we all know in schools, is a teacher. So we have to upskill and develop our teachers because since we have changed our delivery model, our teachers should also learn on how flexible learning would work and how assessment methods would be. Another concern would be how to assess also, because it's really a transformation from face-to-face to flexible to digital or online learning.
All right. Thank you for taking our quick call, Anthony Tamayo of Kokopia. You stay safe.
Okay. Thank you, Nikki. Stay safe.